SpaceX partnered with NASA for its Artemis program, which plans to send humans to the Moon and eventually Mars by 2024. Back on October 2020, NASA awarded 15 different companies more than $370 million for research and development projects related to managing cryogenic propellant in space, lunar surface operations, and autonomous landing technology. More than two-thirds of that funding went to four real in-space demonstrations of cryogenic propellant management and storage from Lockheed Martin, United Launch Alliance, SpaceX, and little-known startup Ada Space. NASA's ambition is faced with a lot of technological problems, one of which involves a transportation system. This is because traveling and building cities in distant destinations, like the Moon and Mars, requires a means of transportation that would carry humans to and from the Moon's surface, and also transport tons of fuel for the duration of the journey to make human life sustainable. On other planets of the Moon, there needs to be a reusable spacecraft to be refueled in orbit, according to SpaceX. The fully reusable Starship system uses in space for propellant transfer, to achieve this and carry people on long-duration interplanetary flights. The SpaceX Star system is a reusable two-stage-to-orbit heavy-lift vehicle. It is the combination of a booster stage named Super Heavy and the second stage, also referred to as Starship. The first stage is being designed as a long-duration cargo, and to transport humans to the Moon, Mars and beyond. The spacecraft will serve as both the second stage and the in-space long-duration orbital spaceship refueling. At the SpaceX Boca Chica facility, SpaceX Starship is coming to life very quickly. The Starship is literally a wonder in aerospace engineering, as it is designed to be a reusable lift rocket that would be able to lift over 150 metric tons around the Earth's orbit. This carries a lot more than the Saturn V. It is the first vehicle that's designed with the primary goal of putting human beings on Mars, and bringing them back to Earth again. The biggest single challenge of trying to colonize Mars is the transportation system. There are other systems that need to work too, but the Starship is designed to be a refueling system at a very low cost. Before it is possible to move people to the Moon and Mars successfully, the engineers have to create a fully reusable rocket, with a payload to orbit and refill it from a return journey. A reusable rocket takes almost all the fuel in the boosters just to get it into orbit. There will be just enough propellant for the ship to deploy and deorbit an aero brake into the atmosphere, using the skydiver or belly flop. To land, these lighting maneuvers will reduce almost all of the orbit velocity in the ship. By the time the ship is in the atmosphere, just a small amount of fuel will be left for the rocket to flip back and land successfully on the launch pad. The Starship is meant to transport fuel to other spaceships already orbiting the Earth. The Starship is built in at least three of these operational variants: SpaceShip, which is a large long-duration spacecraft, capable of carrying passengers or cargo to interplanetary locations; a satellite delivery spacecraft; and a tanker. The tanker is a cargo-only propellant used to support the refilling of propellants. In Earth's orbit, it will enable launching a heavy spacecraft to interplanetary space. As the spacecraft being refueled can use its tanks twice, first to reach low Earth orbit, and afterwards to leave its orbit. Lunar surface to orbit transport is also a variant of Starship, without air brakes or heat shielding, which is required for an in-atmosphere operation. In addition, the ship will be equipped with a docking port, landing engines installed much higher to reduce dust clouds during landing, and will have white paint as opposed to the steel. Starship is made up of a stainless steel structure, and tank construction. Its strength-to-mass ratio can be compared to, or better than, the early SpaceX design. Alternative of carbon fiber composite. Across the anticipated temperature ranges, some of the craft though will be built with a stainless steel alloy that has undergone cryogenic treatments. The spacecraft will also have a thermal protection system against the harsh conditions of atmospheric re-entry. This is also going to include hexagonal ceramic tiles that will be used on the windward side of the Starship. SpaceX plans to intercept the Starship bound for Mars with no less than four fuel tankers. The booster uses the remaining fuel to take it back to Earth and get it ready for reuse. The Starship would not require a fuel depot around the Moon, but would use a fuel depot in orbit around the Earth. With this, SpaceX could refuel a Starship with methane and liquid oxygen propellants required to keep it going. Elon Musk explained the Starship upper stage could be inserted into a parking orbit after separation, allowing it to be refilled with propellant. If you just fly Starship to orbit and don't do any refilling, It's pretty good. You'll get 150 tons to low Earth orbit, and have no fuel to go anywhere else, Musk explained. If you send up tankers and refill in orbit, you could refill the tanks up all the way to the top, and get 150 tons of payload all the way to Mars. To refuel, the spacecraft would dock, or mate, with another Starship, already circling the Earth, that acts solely as a propellant depot. The two ships would actually mate at the rear section. They would use the same mating interface that they use to connect to the booster on liftoff. To transfer propellant, it becomes very simple. You use control thrusters to accelerate in the direction that you want to empty. It must be refueled in orbit. This can be a difficult process, because the Starship is made of reusable material. The Starship has aerodynamic flaps and a heat shield that is used to re-enter the Earth's atmosphere, and four welded steel grid fins to provide aerodynamic control. On its descent, it also has landing legs and other features that subtract from the amount of mass that can be placed in one launch on Earth's orbit. This takes a lot out of the Starship's potential capabilities. Hence, there must be a reliable method of refilling in orbit for the Starship to succeed for the booster. Only 1 kilogram of the orbital payload is lost for every 5 to 10 kilograms of hardware, such as legs and grid fans added to the booster. But the second stage of a Starship, every kilogram propellant mass for Starship recovery and reuse, will result in a reduction of payload capability. It is difficult to say how much fuel is needed to make a trip to Mars. The Starship can roughly hold around 200 metric tons of fuel, so it's gonna need a lot of tanks to refuel in lower Earth orbit. SpaceX needs to employ a lot of new technology, along with the technology needed to refill. The technology used in making the space vehicle needs to be constantly visited and revisited. This is already seen with the creation of the Raptor engine, with a design that allows the possibility of the engine using fuel made both on Earth and Mars, as mentioned earlier. In doing so, NASA is effectively testing the tolerance of political stakeholders in programs like Orion and SLS, programs that exist more to preserve jobs and prop up congressional stakeholders. If a magnitudes cheaper and more capable solution like distributed launch and orbital refueling were demonstrated under NASA's own purview, it might become a lot harder to defend heritage programs that have been hemorrhaging approximately 20% of the space agency's annual budget for almost a decade. SpaceX won $53.2 million for a large-scale flight demonstration to transfer 10 metric tons of liquid oxygen between tanks on a Starship vehicle. Notably, this seems to imply that NASA is effectively funding a single-ship orbital flight test, in which a Starship prototype will most likely attempt to transfer liquid oxygen between its main LOX tank and a smaller header tank. NASA is beginning to put some serious money where its mouth is, to develop a wide range of innovative solutions that may enable sustainable human space exploration. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching, and goodbye.